as I was sitting there, I really just the presence of the Lord really good, and I just really appreciate the Holy Spirit and what He's doing, because it just, don't you love it when in your life, when you see the Holy Spirit doing things, it just confirms and just begins to do things, you're like, should I even have thought that you would have done it any different, you know? And as I sat there, I thought, you know what? Would all the fathers stand? You know, this is the kind of morning where I think we just need to get rid of the rules. Which is amazing, because what the Lord gave me is about not following the rules. And look around you, you see men, you see fathers. And a few weeks ago, the Lord spoke something to me, and He said, Daron, I'm looking for one man who's willing to not follow any rules, but is willing to follow the Redeemer. Who's willing to love his wife like I love her. Who's willing to love his kids like I love them. Who's willing to love a church and invest himself in it and love a city. Says, I'm looking for one man who's willing to take up his cross and deny himself and follow me. Jesus was one man who did it. And we're all here because that one man chose to lay down his life, and in resurrection power, we are here. So my challenge for every father today and future fathers is that you would ask the Holy Spirit, I want to be that man. I want to be the one that's willing to sacrifice whatever has to be done to yield to you, to do what has to be done to see this world come to Christ, to inherit the fullness of what you have for me as a man. That's what the Lord wants. Forget about the rules. Forget about things. Just say, Lord, it's all about you. It's all about you and following you. I don't care what nobody says. Isn't that what the song said? I don't care what nobody says. If I am alone, I will follow you. Nobody else is following. It doesn't matter. My eyes are fixed as a man upon the King of Kings, and I will follow him even to my death. Even to my death. Now, everyone that is seated, we're going to pray for these men and release into their lives a willingness to give it all up, to lay it all down, to be a father, to be a friend, to be a co-worker, to be that one who said, Holy Spirit, speak to me throughout each moment of the day that I may impart life to those around me. Would you just stretch your hands towards these men, and we just pray, Father, send the Holy Spirit to every person that's standing in this room, to every father. You are a father. And you understand, because your heart wants to be released into these men today. And so we do that. Release the power of the Holy Spirit. Release the love of the Holy Spirit today into your hearts. That you would be willing to step up and say, I am going to do whatever the Holy Spirit tells me to do. No matter what situation you're in, no matter what circumstances comes about, I'm going to take that stand and be used by the power of the Holy Spirit today. I release these men to walk into the fullness of everything that you have for them, that they will love like they've never loved before. They will have grace like they've never had grace before. They will walk in righteousness, your righteousness, like they've never experienced before. And as you open their eyes, and you open their hearts to your dream, you will place in them the faith to step forward and see it fulfilled. We bless you, we love you, and I thank you for these men and the great things you're doing in every one of them as sons of the King. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, guys. Matthew 9 is where our one of the texts I'll talk to you about today in Galatians 5. Pastor Mike has been doing a series in Galatians, so he has covered a lot of the history of what's going on in Galatians. And as I began to prepare for this, the Lord just began to lead me towards this particular event that took place in Jesus' life. And the context of this is, everybody remembers the story when Jesus was in the Gadarenes and he cast out the demons out and they went into the pigs, got into a boat, and came back to the other side to his hometown. So he is in his hometown and he goes to his house and he's sitting in the house. And all these people are gathered around Jesus. I mean, crowds of people are packed into this house. And this is early in Jesus' ministry. All the disciples yet, he's got one more yet to call. And so he's in this house, and all these people are gathered around him. There's John's disciples, Pharisees, scribes, just all kinds of people crowded in around him. And all of a sudden, as he's sitting there, the roof opens up, and they drop this guy down right in the middle of this whole meeting. Y'all remember the story, and this guy can't walk, you know, and they can't get to him because there's people just so packed in the house, they can't get to him. And so they just, we got to get to him, so let's just open up the roof. That's pretty desperate. But I think the Lord is looking for those kind of people, just like what we just prayed. Whatever it takes, if we have to tear the roof off to get to his presence, to be the center of my life, let's get to it. And so they drop him. You know, he heals him. And you remember the story, the Pharisees, instead of being in awe of the fact that here's a guy who healed someone, he did something good for a man, they were like, well, what do you mean you could forgive sins? Well, who do you think you are? Well, Jesus is like, well, just to show you that I can do this, rise up, walk. And everybody is like, whoa! It actually says some of them were afraid. They were afraid. The presence of God in the midst of these people who had not experienced that for some time, or probably never, all of a sudden the presence of God in the midst of this crowded group, did you see that? Walk, and he took up his mat and walked right out that crowded front door. I can imagine, oh, you know, you can just imagine what happened. And then Jesus gets up, and he heads off and goes down to the shore, and it's like this parade. They're all following him. You know, he's just kind of walking, and imagine a parade of people, and he's just leading this parade. He goes down to the seashore, and it says he just began to teach them there. And so he's teaching, because he's got this crowd constantly around him. And so he's teaching there, and then he decides to, I'm just kind of not filling in all the details, but giving you the brief, okay? This is my version. So he decides to go back to the house, and as he goes back to the house, he passes this tax collector's booth, and there's Levi, Matthew, sitting there. And all he says to him, follow me. Two words, follow me. What does he do? He leaves, drops everything, follows him. Amazing! Follow me. It's all he gets. Well, he's been hearing about it. Probably saw the crowd walk by. I said, wonder where they're going. Wow. Maybe he saw the paralytic guy come running down the street. I've been healed. I don't know. But all of a sudden, Jesus walks back by and he sees me. And the Holy Spirit says, I want that man on the team. All right, you follow me. He follows him. They're back in the house again. Okay, they're back in the same house again. Sun shining through the roof. Through the hole in the roof. They're sitting around. All these people are gathered in again. And here's we are in Matthew chapter 9 in verse 14. And instead of being in awe of everything that Jesus has been doing, they have this question. Why don't your disciples fast? Because John's disciples fast and the Pharisees fast. So what's up with that? Why aren't you following the rules? A good boy of God, a good man of God follows the rules, right? Now remember who's here in this crowd. John's disciples, their leader has been arrested. John's in prison. And they're like, what do we do now? John had declared, this is the Son of God. This is him. This is the one. I came as a forerunner. This is the guy. And so now they've probably been wandering around Like, well, do we follow this guy? I mean, what do we do? Repent the kingdom of heaven? That's the message we've had, you know? And I'm sure the Pharisees, you know, they're like, well, you know, following the rules is very important. So if you guys will just begin to apply that message of repent, the kingdom of heaven is at hand, and let's apply these rules to that. And the Pharisees are standing there looking at Jesus, and look, why are they doing that? And over throughout Scripture, you'll see where they're always, why are you picking the heads of grain on the Sabbath? Why are you healing on the Sabbath? It's always about the rules with them. So you got a bunch of people gathered around who have been used to the rules. It's always been about the rules. Following the rules. Fitting into this little box. And if you go outside that box, they're like, well, you can't be of God. Because God created these rules. And that's how far Judaism had come away from this original intent of God's heart. You remember the law? Moses came off a mountain. His face is shining. The presence of God is on him. And he's got the commandments, you know. And the commandments were about what? The law to draw you to him into a relationship with the presence of the Father. That's what it was about. And here it is, years and years and years later, and they have added hundreds of rules to the original 10. They have changed it so that it's just us view. And maybe we'll let you and you and you, if you follow the rules right enough, we'll let you in the group. And they sat there wondering, you know what? Their guys are not fasting. Why aren't they fasting? Because a man of God would be fasting. And not only would be, you know, this public display thing is what they were looking for. They were looking for these outward signs of following the rules, because that's what the Pharisees were used to doing. Praying when everybody could see them praying, walking around with their robes and got their, you know, I almost went too far ahead of myself. And they like these outward signs. So this is the context of in Matthew chapter 9 where Jesus is dealing with people pressing in on him to follow the rules. And what's interesting as I was preparing this, I noticed something about the presence of God and people that surround him. You ever notice in the Old Testament when the people of Israel, I mean, the Jews came out of Egypt, God put his presence in the middle of them and said, start following me. And then for 40 years, as they followed him, he began to weed out those that still thought like Egypt, that still tasted Egypt, that still desired Egypt. And for 40 years, as his presence walked in the middle and they would watch his presence, oh, he's moving today, let's all pack up and go. They would follow him, keeping their eyes on him. He stopped. Okay, camp right here. And over 40 years, the desire for following the rules in slavery began to die off. And it was all about the presence. And here it is again, Jesus in the presence of people surrounded by it. And here they are wanting to follow the rules again. Read with me. Chapter 9. Verse 14, then the disciples of John came to him saying, why do we and the Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast? And Jesus said to them, can the wedding guests mourn as long as the bridegroom is with them? The days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast. Look, he uses a picture. You know what a parable is? A parable is when you have a kingdom principle, a kingdom truth put in a story that you and I can understand or try to grasp. It's a process of the kingdom. It's a way of living that's above us. So God's ways are higher than our ways. It's a process of living that God puts down into a natural means for us to be able to grasp and understand. And here, they ask him about fasting. He says, well, the bridegroom is here. The guests are not going to mourn or fast while the groom is here. There's going to be rejoicing in the presence of the bridegroom. Well, we know that the Father, Jesus, is the bridegroom. And while his presence are here, we enjoy that presence. We enjoy him being here, and we rejoice, and we walk with him, and we just have great pleasure in enjoying his presence. He says, but there's going to come a day when the bridegroom will be gone, and then you will fast. Because they misunderstood the purpose of fasting. They thought it was about an outward show, but not. That's not what fasting is about. Fasting is about humbling ourselves, lowering ourselves, and recognizing, you know what? I want to be a little more sensitive to what the king is doing. And so if I deny my flesh certain privileges, like eating, then that will cause a little bit more sensitivity to the spirit going on inside of me. That's what fasting is about. It's not an outward show. It's not following the rules. He says, when the bridegroom's gone, then they will fast. Why? Because they want to be more sensitive to his presence. Because it's always about his presence. And here's their big question. I say it over and over again. Is Jesus following the rules? And Judaism had become a rule-based religion. The disciples started right with repentance, but where they were derailed by pressure to conform to the religious rules. Talking about John's disciples. They were told, repent. That's the starting place. But because of the pressure by the Pharisees, they were being, what did Paul say? Bewitched. They were being bewitched by people telling them, you got to apply some rules to that. He goes on and says, verse 16. No one puts a piece of unshrunk cloth on an old garment, for the patch tears away from the garment, and a worse tear is made. It's interesting, the Greek word for unshrunk there means it's not finished. It's new, but not complete. And what was great about this passage in dealing with Galatians chapter 5, and when Jesus spoke this, he says, you don't take a piece of cloth that's new, but and you tear it away and you add it to something that's old. And remember the context of the situation. All these people around him saying, why aren't you following the rules? This is the way God does business, and you're not living by the rules. And Jesus says, you don't take this new piece and apply it to this old way. If not, it creates damage to the new and the old. And that's what he's talking about. This unshrunk cloth that's not finished, he's talking about his work that's being done on the earth that will soon be completed. He hasn't yet gone to the cross. And when he goes to the cross, remember he said, my message is for who? The Jewish people. And when he goes to the cross and he dies and he pours out his spirit, then it is expanded to the Gentiles also, to all of us. That's when the gospel will be complete. And here he's talking about a piece of unshrunk, incomplete cloth added to an old system, and they're incompatible with one another. And you'll see in a minute how that relates to what's going on in Galatians. New wine. Verse 17. Neither is new wine put into old wineskins. If it is, the skins burst, and the wine is spilled, and the skins are destroyed. But new wine is put into fresh wineskins, and so both are preserved. It's interesting, there were two Greek words here that were used by Jesus, and it's the word new. And each Greek word was different. New meaning neos in the Greek, and new meaning kainos in the Greek. Two different Greek words. And it's interesting how he uses them. He says, neither is new neos wine put into old wineskins. If it is, the skins burst. They're spilled out. And the wine is spilled, and the skins are destroyed. But new wine, neos wine, is put into fresh, or new, as some translations use, kainos wineskins. Why is that significant? Because Jesus said that, well, let me explain first. Neos in the Greek means a certain time. There's a certain time every year where we have Father's Day. There's a time for a birthday. There's a time for Christmas. Neos meaning a new time for something to happen. And here's a new wine in time being poured into a kainos wineskin. Kainos meaning it's new in nature. It's new in character. It's brand new. And so you don't put a new wine into old wineskins. Because what happens? The fermentation process will take place. It expands the skins. They will bust. And all that new wine is poured out and lost. So what's interesting in studying this, there were two descriptions of wineskins. There was first the person who, the belief that this was a brand new wineskin, completely new. It never had wine in it before. And then there was this other interpretation that it was a wineskin that had been used, but it had been refurbished or redone. And what does that mean? Well, what they would do to a renewed wineskin that had already had fermentation, they would take that and soak it in water for a few days. I thought, wow, this is great. Not only can you be born again brand new, but you can be renewed. Take that wineskin and they put it in water, the washing of the water of the word, and they put it down in there for a few days and let it just soak and get soft again. Then they take it out of there, and you know what they did next? They put oil. They begin to pour oil. Boy, you know what that means. The anointing of the Holy Spirit was put upon that wineskin, and it made it soft and pliable again. Then what was poured in it? Brand new wine of the life of God poured into that wineskin. It could have been a brand new wineskin for the first time receiving the newness in it, or it could be a refurbished, a redeemed. We sung about that. Redeemed. At any moment, the Lord can redeem us and wash us and anoint us and fill us new. And Jesus says, you don't put this new wine into an old skin. It cannot handle it. And here he is with all these people around him. He says, I have a new message. The presence of God is among you, and it will not mix with the old ways. It will not mix. And this challenged me because it's been a long time since Jesus was here, as in he physically. And just like Judaism, I think Christianity has some way conformed just like Judaism. It's almost as if there's a parallel that if we're not careful, we begin to control what God did and we begin to change what originally was his presence and we change to the rules. They got to follow the rules. And some places in Christianity, we see that very same thing. It's about following the rules. You got to look this way, dress this way, talk this way, go to that church. I mean, how many churches you see has got their name? It's Eric and I used to laugh at San Antonio. They would come up with all these odd names. You know, this is Faith Church, and, you know, this is, you know, on and on. I'm like, wow, that's great. And they how they define themselves. And I think in Christianity, we have to be very careful that we don't allow the rule mentality of the Pharisees begin to creep in and take the presence out and follow the rules. That's what I loved about this morning. I mean, if it was me, I would like, let's all just go outside and do a service. Let's just break all the rules. You know what? Let's just, you guys move over here, and you guys move over there, and you guys move up here, and y'all move back there, and you guys, let's just break the rules and stretch us a little bit, because that's what new wine will do. It stretches you. Because he wants to do something different. That's what I loved about this morning. Chris even said it, man, this is different. It's good. You know, you get in these situations, it's like, Lord, this is odd. But worship me right there in that new situation. Live for me right there in that new place. You know, we had our little block party last week or so, whenever it was, and we began to worship outside. And it had been a long time since I worshiped outside. And you know, you could get distracted. You know, you're out in the sun and, you know, the sounds is a little different and the seating is a little different and everybody's dressed a little different and there's activities going on and kids playing and you begin to worship. And I was really stretched in that moment. I said, God, where are you at? This is different. And the Lord says, don't put me in that box. Don't put me in rules. I can be wherever you are. I said, that is awesome. I want to be a wineskin that will stretch wherever he wants, whatever he wants to do, so I can pour out that life unto whoever needs it. Just pour it out. And that's what we find in Galatians chapter 5. Pastor Mike said, take Galatians 5. And I was like, wow, that's loaded. It is loaded. And so the Lord just gave me real specifics, and I'm going to end it up, and we'll talk about A and W for a few minutes. Now, in chapter 4, verse 1, it says this, as long as the heir is a child, they're no different than a slave. You know why that makes sense to me? Because I have kids. I would not turn over the running of our house, Eric and I, paying the bills, mowing the yard, taking care of the business of my house to my children. Would you? Absolutely not, because they're children. They might get some things done. They might know how to wash a dish, put them in the dishwasher. They can run the vacuum cleaner. You know, there's some things that, but there's certain children at different ages know different things, but there's no way I would turn over the more important things about family life over to my kids. It's not going to happen. I mean, y'all seen little Hannah? We could have the house completely clean. Carpets vacuumed, everything straight. And our house is a very baby-safe house. You know, it's just nothing. Everything's wood. It can't break anything. Nothing's going to fall. Everything is breakable 6 foot high. You know, she'd have to really climb to get it. But little Hannah, it's amazing how she has no sense of cleanness, no sense of personal priority or responsibility. She'll just go through the house, pick something up, drop it. Go through the house, pick something up, drop it. Change this dress and put on another dress and leave it laying right there. She'll change these shoes. You know, she's really, really a princess. She'll want these shoes for a minute, and then she decides she didn't want them, so she'll sit down, take those off, and leave them there and go find something else to do. And then she'll get into the cupboard. We got a chip drawer down low, and you pull out chips, and there'll be a chip here and a chip there, and there'll be this here. And before long, this almost three-year-old will undo an hour or 2 hours of cleaning all by herself. And when I read that verse, I thought, yeah, as long as the heir is a child, they're no different than a slave. She is just a slave to whatever she wants to do. Whatever. And if she doesn't like it, she'll do, ah! You could tell the fake ones from the real ones. You know, like Eric and I will be sitting in there and we hear and we're like, what are they doing in there? Oh, that's a fake cry. She's all right. You can tell the ones where she might be hurt, you know, or Zach was wrestling with her. Oh, sorry, you know, or something. But anyway, but the point is this. If the heir is a child, they're like a slave. Put that upon you and I for a minute. And then look at what Paul says in Galatians 5, verse 1. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. Slavery, slavery. What are you talking about? Stop acting like a child. It's time to grow up and walk into the freedom that you possess. See, that's what Paul says. It was for freedom that you are free. You see it? For freedom that you are now free. So let's stop acting like a child and grow up. Step into the process of maturity and begin to go towards the freedom that we have been given freely in Christ Jesus. But notice what he says. He says there, don't submit to it. Don't yield to it as slavery. Don't yield to following the rules. Yield to the Redeemer who is our freedom. Let's read this passage, Galatians chapter 5. Awesome. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. Look, I, Paul, say to you that if you accept circumcision as following the rules, old system of Judaism, you got to conform to all these outward rules, Christ will be of no advantage to you. Now, this is a pretty powerful statement. He's saying, look, don't be a child in verse 1, because if you're like a child, you're a slave. A slave to what? A slave to whatever rules you. Hannah will do whatever she wants until we stop her. That's the way children will. They're unruly, and so it's our job as parents to train them how to live in the presence in a relationship with the Father. And there are rules we have to establish. There are good rules. Don't get me wrong. You know, we have to drive on the right side of the street. There's a speed limit for a purpose. There are rules that are good to protect. But in the realm of walking in our relationship with Jesus Christ, we have to be careful what rules we follow, what we're submitting to. Look, I, Paul, say to you that if you accept circumcision, Christ will be of no advantage to you. I testify again to every man who accepts circumcision that he is obligated to keep the whole law. Yikes, that's a big burden to bear if you decide to do it your way and not the Father's way. If you decide to follow the rules because this relationship thing requires a lot of me, but the rules are easy. They're very defined. Because walking with Jesus is a walk of faith. Walking with Jesus is not seeing necessarily what's going to be next. And that could be a challenge that requires trust. Trusting in the Father requires faith. Abraham, I don't know where I'm going. I'll just follow you, Father. And so he followed him. He just left. Now Moses, I'll go back to Pharaoh. I was raised. He's a pretty powerful guy. Just go. Here's your message. Let him go. Okay. If you're going to live by the rules, then you have to obey all the rules. But listen to what Paul says. Paul is to the point. I testify again to every man who accepts circumcision that he is obligated to keep the whole law. You are severed from Christ. You who would be justified by law. If you and I think that for one moment our works and following the rules will get us anything with God, we are deceived. Doesn't matter how much you read. It doesn't matter if you're there every time the doors open to church. Doesn't matter how people you witness to. If it's all about you following rules and that's pleasing Father, it's wrong. You are severed from Christ, you who would be justified by the law. You have, this was amazing, fallen away from grace. Grace empowers us to live a righteous life. Grace empowers us to be free. It was for freedom that Christ set us free. It is grace that gives us the power to walk the freedom that he has for us. But the law strips that away. You're on your own. And he says, if you're going to follow the rules, follow the law, then you better obey them all. And that's what Jesus is dealing with in, with his situation. With all these people surrounding him, they're questioning about following the rules. And it's never about the rules. It's about his presence. Loving him, obeying him, and following him and what he says to do. For through the Spirit, by faith, we ourselves eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness. By the Spirit, through faith, we're waiting for that which Jesus accomplished to be fulfilled in our lives. We are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. That's what he did for us. That's who we are as sons and daughters of the King. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision counts for anything, but only faith working through love. You were running well. Who hindered you from obeying the truth? This persuasion is not from him who calls you. Look what he says. A little leaven, just a little compromise, is going to infect the entire person. The moment we begin to just embrace just a little bit of fleshly indulgence, fleshly rules to get to the kingdom, that little seed will begin to take over our soul. You remember what our soul is? Our soul is our thoughts, our will, and our emotions. And that's what was happening in that situation with Jesus. John's disciples were getting confused. John's gone, what do we do? And they're being influenced by the Pharisees, and they see the presence of God on Jesus, and like, what's happening? They're having this question, why aren't you doing what they say you should be doing? And Jesus, it's not about that. It's about loving the Father and allowing the newness of my wine to fill a reconditioned, brand new soul that's in love with me. It's not about following rules. It's about following the Father. Continue with me reading. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. I have confidence in the Lord that you will take no other view, and that the one who is troubling you will bear the penalty, whoever he is. But if I, brothers, still preach circumcision, why am I still being persecuted? In that case, the offense of the cross has been removed. I wish those who unsettled you would emasculate themselves. Wow. I wish you'd be in a condition where you can't reproduce anything. You need to just get away. Because what you're doing is spreading, like leaven, you're spreading lies that lead people away from the truth. Amen. A couple things and I'll finish up. Verse 13, for you were called to freedom, brothers. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love, serve one another. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. So he's clearly defining, here's your boundaries. I told young people this one time a while back when I was a youth pastor, and I said, look, you guys don't have, the only one you have to obey in life now is Jesus when you belong to him. And boy, their eyes lit up. Jesus is your master. Jesus is your king. He's the one in control. He's the one that tells you what to do. He's the only one who's in control of your life. Obey him only. And they were like, yeah, I don't have to obey my parents. I said, if the Lord will let you get away with it. I don't have to obey my teachers. If the Holy Spirit lets you get away with that, then go ahead. I said, the point is, when you surrender to the Father, you're surrendering to his purpose and his will, and that means honor, love, respect. Do what he's telling you to do. And that's a greater call than trying to conform to the rules. Mom, Dad said, I got to clean up my room now. Well, I got to go do this now, and I got to do that, and I got to do my homework. But when the Father's in control, it's more of, yes, sir, I go get it done. See the difference in perspective. One, it's about following the rules, and the other one's about a relationship. That's the same with us. Let's not be a child or a slave to the elementary things about, I got to do this, and I got to go to church, and I got to, that's a child thinking. Let's walk into a relationship where it's the Father who determines life. Verse 16. Oh, by the way, verse 15 is a great, great verse. But if you bite and devour one another, watch out that you are not consumed by one another. This is what happens when we're not walking in freedom. You begin to bite and devour one another. These little arguments begin to rise up. The little seeds of, what are you doing? What's up with you? They didn't come to church this week. You know, you just get this little stuff going on that's not of the Spirit. And we'll talk about that more in a second. Verse 16, a couple Greek words that are pretty powerful I found in here. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. Now this word, walk by the Spirit, is peripateo. Peripateo, I know that means nothing to us. I'll forget it after tomorrow too. But the principle is true. Here this word means, in your daily individual activities, as you live life as a believer, you're walking around doing your daily things. It's you as an individual living out the Christian life. You're walking around doing the daily activities. And what he says here, but I say peripateo by the Spirit. Not on your own. Peripateo, walking around doing whatever you do throughout the day. It's ironing or cleaning or working, slinging a hammer. Peripateo, your activities, by the Spirit, not the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. It's like these two things going on inside of our soul. The Lord kind of showed me the picture of a garden, remember the Garden of Eden, and a cemetery. And the Spirit wants the garden to expand and take over the territory of the cemetery. But as soon as we begin to feed into the cemetery, it begins to expand and take over the ground of the garden. And there's this constant battle of territory. I want this territory. And it's all up to us who we surrender to, who we walk by. And I want the garden to continue to expand. Isn't that what the original intent in the garden was? Adam and Eve, this is your place to inherit. I give it to you. Be fruitful, multiply, fill, take dominion, and I want that garden to expand and encompass the entire earth. Take it over. That's in our life. That it would grow and expand and take over by the Spirit everything about us. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other to keep you from doing the things you want to do. What do you want to do? We want to live for God. I want to see God pour out His Spirit in my life, but the flesh is against that. Flesh wants us to back off and conform to some other set of boundaries, some other set of rules, and do it His way. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now, the works of the flesh. Interesting. Did a little study on these, and I got to break this down into my notes today. The Lord just speaking to me like crazy. And I'm like, all right, what am I going to say? Lord, you got so much to say. These works of the flesh. I'm going to read them first, talk about something, and then go back and look at them. Now, the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now, why I said I won't go past it, because we got to get a clear understanding of what it means by to inherit the kingdom of God. Eric and I had this discussion. When we go to heaven, we don't need to do anything else. What I mean is, when we go to heaven, we will not need faith anymore. When we go to heaven, we will not have to fight against sin anymore. When we go to heaven, there will be these new bodies. When we go to heaven, the struggle is over. You see what I'm talking about? So inheriting the kingdom, as long as the heir is a child, is no different than a slave. So you can't inherit something until you grow up. You see what I'm talking about? Inheriting something. So if you're going to inherit the kingdom, we have to grow by the Spirit. And here's what he's saying. If you see these activities, these things, don't expect the kingdom of God to be poured out into your life. Don't expect to see the power and presence of God like you see in Jesus' life. It's not going to happen. God wants us to inherit. Look, when he says, pray this way, your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, that means he wants us to inherit here on earth as God has completed it in heaven. Everything that the Father has for us is done. It's complete. Jesus paid the price. And we get to inherit it. Now, can you dream it, though? Can you ask the Father, can I have a dream and a vision big enough to see what you want me to inherit? Am I just to wander around on earth till I die? And, you know, I heard a statement Who was it that said it? I can't remember who it was now. But he said, if people believe that they will be under the rule of sin till they die, then death has become their deliverer and not Jesus. If you think that sin will control you and control the rest of your life, then Jesus is not the deliverer for you. Death is. And I thought, whoa, how often I have given up because I just can't overcome that. I just can't. Every day it just comes back to me. And that just, and I keep giving into it. And I began to fall in a trap of doing it by my works, by my understanding, by the knowledge of good and evil. And I failed every time and did not realize that Jesus is my deliverer from the power of sin. Not someday when I die and get to go to heaven and rejoice. He is my deliverer now. So whatever that is in our lives that is oppressing us, whatever addiction that is that's keeping us enslaved, he can free that. He can set us free from that. Look what he says. Those who practice these things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now these group of sins are, I found a great study on these. They put them in, this guy put them in four groups. There are sexual sins, religious sins, interpersonal relationship sins, and sins affiliated with alcohol abuse. Sexual sins, we talk about immorality and sensuality. Immorality, the Greek word there is porneia. No explanation of what that means. If there is an inkling of any type of thing in our lives that's giving way to sex driving us, it controls our behavior. It determines my thinking. It determines my feelings. It controls me. Then we can't inherit the great grace of the kingdom. And I'm not saying you're not saved. I think that's a big misunderstanding. People think that if they see that in their lives, then that must have never been saved. That's a lie from the pit of hell. You could be a child of God and struggle and see something there. You just need deliverance from that because our Father is the deliverer. That's why he sent Jesus to deliver us. Truth sets us free. That's the process that Pastor Mike was talking about. We are justified. He lives in us. We are a brand new creation. Our spirit is alive. The soul is being sanctified of all that stuff that was put in there before we became a Christian or even born with. Sin dominated it. And he wants to sanctify the soul, clean us, wash us, make us brand new. And these things here show that we need deliverance and healing so that we can inherit all the goodness of the kingdom, not living like a slave anymore, not living like a child. Immorality and sensuality. Religious sins such as idolatry. What is idolatry? Idolatry is trusting in anything other than God to meet my needs. What are your needs? Well, the basic needs of food and water and breathing. But other needs? What about relational needs? Being valuable, having a sense of belonging, all those things that God gives us, identity. When we trust in something other than the Father, it's called idolatry. And that's exactly what the Pharisees and disciples of John did. They began to trust in their abilities and were trying to impress that lie upon Jesus, and he never gave to it because he knew who he was. It was declared, you're my son, and you, I am well pleased. Who are you? Son and daughter in whom God is well pleased, don't give way to the lies. Sorcery was another one. Manipulation, manipulating others to get what you want. Interpersonal relationship sins, enmity, strife, jealousy, outbursts of anger, disputes, dissensions, factions. When we see these things, we're seeing the flesh in control and not the spirit in control. Just a sign. Just a little, you know, in the Word of God good, it just kind of begins to identify something. Ooh, yeah. Father, I come back and I surrender that little enmity that I have, that little thought that I have, that little feeling that I had towards them or whatever's going on. I surrender that because I want to be led by the Spirit. So as you're led by the Spirit, he will identify something. He'll point it out. But if we walk in the flesh, we'll never get pointed out. It'll increase. It becomes a cemetery. It begins to grow and grow and grow and grow till our whole life is infected by those things. And you will not see God move in your life because of that. Now let's move on. But, it's one of our favorite verses here, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things, there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus, have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. The fruit growing in us is a sign that the Spirit of God is in control. And it may start small. That's one thing great the Lord shows me about fruit, is that it starts small and begins to grow. When you begin to give way to His leadership and yielding to Him, He takes control and begins to implant love and joy. And the more I surrender to that and more I yield to Him, He begins to put more in there and begins to consume more of my soul and heart, and I'll see more love in my life and more joy and more peace and more grace and more goodness being given out. And that's a process. So don't get discouraged because of the process may be long. It takes us a walk every day, getting up in the morning and say, Father, I yield today. I yield to You. Let's do it Your way. Peripateo, remember that word. Walking around in your individual daily activities, surrendering to the Holy Spirit. Verse 25. Look at verse 25. If we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step with the Spirit. Now, Paul uses a different Greek word. Remember, he said, walk by the Spirit. Here he says, if we live by the Spirit. This word here is stoicheo. This is a group of people yielding to the Spirit. He went from an individual now to a group of people yielding, like a group here. That we choose to say, you know what, as a body, we yield to You, Holy Spirit. We want Your presence in this place so that we can be used as a body in the city to reach out wherever we go to work, wherever we live our lives. The Father wants to pour out His Spirit in a group of people and transform where they live. Let us not become conceited. What is the result of not living by the Spirit of God? He said, let us not become conceited, provoking one another and envying one another. That is what happens whenever we not submitted and a group of people would begin to see conceit, arrogance. We provoke one another and we envy one another in a group, in a body. Pastor Mike talked about A and W. We'll finish up. A&W man, talking to the men right now. When we walk by the Spirit, God will make us available and willing. He will make us available and willing to follow Him and obey Him, willing to do whatever He calls us to do. He'll also anoint us and make us a worshiper. That's what we need, men who are anointed and who are worshipers. They don't care what people think. I worship God wherever we go. In the job site, wherever it is, I'm going to worship the Lord with my life. That's what the Spirit will do. Work through us and we'll be a worshiper and anointed by Him. That when we see a situation, we can pray into that and speak life into that situation. But there's also that flesh side where they're absent and withdrawn. The constant pull of being absent in the lives of our family, absent as a believer, and we just don't even interact, we just back off, we don't say anything, we don't do anything, we don't make any effort, we just back off and withdrawn, or angry and wicked. That's what the flesh produces. And we men, we become angry at everything going on, dissatisfied with maybe life choices you make, you become dissatisfied with things that's going on, and become angry, and what sets in is wickedness. We begin to do things of the flesh that we read about. We begin to see those sins begin to crop up in our lives, and we begin to entertain them. The Father in heaven has called us men to be A&W men. We will be submitted to Him, anointed by Him, that we would follow Him and yield to Him every moment of every day. And that really applies to all of us, not just the men. It applies to all of us to be A&W people. Amen? Y'all stand with me, please. Father, we thank You and love You. Thank You for Your life that You give us. Thank You for setting us free, because it was for freedom that You have set us free. And today, Father, I pray that we would take another step towards that freedom. If there are any childish ways in us, that You would expose them, and that we would step into maturity. We would step into a place of yielding to You each moment and understanding that's a good process. Recognizing it's a good thing to yield to the process of growth, but that we're not withdrawn from that process. That we're not going to stay away from that process. And we're not going to be absent from the process of growth, but we're going to apply ourselves and be willing to give ourselves humbly to You for the growth of the Spirit, so that we may see the kingdom come and Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We love You. We praise You. In Jesus' name, amen.